All right, so I want to extend my gratitude to Aerie and also to Joyce Moy for inviting me to speak at the Aerie Lecture Series, and of course to Anthony for his organization of this event, and it is such a joy to be here and speak at Aerie. All right, so where do I begin, right? This is kind of people's questions about the book and why there's this conceptualization of this project. So let's talk about the beginning of this project. I mean, I'm not gonna lie, incidental racialization began as my dissertation. And this looks nothing like my dissertation, right? For those of us who've written dissertations, you know, they kind of, we just finish them and then we put them away and then we work on them some more, maybe. So as someone interested in race, ethnicity, or what I call panethnicity, and we can talk about why I use panethnicity, and as someone who is interested in how these matters operate in our world, I was intrigued by how race may or may not matter during these processes of professional socialization. And what I mean by professional socialization is learning how to become a professional, whether it be a lawyer, a doctor, a dentist, etc., right? We all go through these processes of socialization. So truth be told, as I mentioned in my book, my husband was a first-year law student where I started rethinking my research interests. I'd always been interested in race and ethnicity, but I needed something more, right? So he was a law student, and we lived in LA, and LA is big, and it can take a long time to commute from point A to point B, and we like never saw each other because I was a grad student, he was a law student, so we tried to make things work. And I would go with him to law school on Fridays, and we would hang out on the car ride that could be 45 minutes to 3 hours, right, depending on traffic. And so he'd go to his classes, and I would sit in the law school cafe and read over my own things, right, during the day. And I sat amongst these law students that spoke in this vocabulary I did not quite understand, right? They said these things like civ pro. I didn't know what civ pro meant. Or crim law. I figured out crim law was criminal law. And or torts. I don't know what torts is. It's some legal term, but not a dessert to my disappointment. So as I was there, you know, hearing these words, I was kind of pondering, why is there such an interesting specific language, right, to this particular field? And at the same time, it seemed as if these law students engaged in fashion shows. I would witness these students come into the cafe in t-shirts, shorts, and flip-flops, because this is LA and they can do this, right, year-round, we can't. So they would come in and then they would leave, and then the same students would come back in suits, right? And then they would leave, and then they'll come back again in the same flip-flop, t-shirt, shorts, attire. And I was like, what is going on? What's this fashion show stuff happening, right? In law school as well. I come to find out later they were interviewing for jobs, right? So they can't wear their shorts and flip-flops. They had to change into their suits. So there's that component of socialization that I found intriguing. And the cafe was actually boring at times too, right? I got bored. He was in class all day. I got bored. I needed to do stuff. So I would roam the law school classrooms or the hallways. And what I found were these flyers advertising for various racialized groups, the organizations for these groups, right? So there would be like the Asian Pacific American Law Student Association. There would be the La Raza Law Student Association, the Black Law Student Association. Well, that got me thinking, because in graduate school, there wasn't the, you know, Asian American Sociology Student Association. There would be like two of us, right, if there was. And there wasn't like a graduate student of color association. So what is it about law school that necessitated, right, these organizations? And what are these organizations doing there? And by doing a little digging, it appeared that most, if not all, law schools house these pan-ethnic organizations. And so it wasn't just specific to this particular law school. But the question was really why? Why are they there? Professional socialization is often thought to be a rather neutral experience, if you will. People kind of think if you've made it, right, especially as immigrants, if you've made it into these professions, then nothing else perhaps matters, right, because you didn't have obstacles making it there. David Wilkins, law professor at Harvard Law, calls this assumption bleached out. But as Wilkins reminds us, becoming a professional, becoming a lawyer is far from neutral, but actually rather nuanced. And so the gist of my book is really, how do these nuances matter in professional socialization? So for one, let's take a quiz, right? We may recognize these folks. Okay, we should recognize at least one person on this slide, if not anybody else, and that is okay. So let's start by looking at some prominent legal scholars of color. We have Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor, right? That's the one we all recognize. And then we have District Judge Derek Watson, who's notable for blocking the current president's travel ban, right? Federal Judge Gonzalo Curiel, and Associate Justice for the California Supreme Court, Goodwin Liu. Now, these individuals overcame barriers and adversity to arrive at where they are today as legal scholars and as justices. And some may argue that they continue to experience discrimination in a way that is not made available for others with race and gender privilege. And so Sonia Sotomayor has written and spoken extensively on these issues, right? And Goodwin Liu actually recently partnered with Yale law students to conduct a study on the experiences of Asian American law students and lawyers. And the findings are actually quite fascinating. We can talk about that later, should you be interested. So here's the thing. If these two justices experienced bleached out professional socialization while they're both at Yale, then we wouldn't see a need for such memoirs or such studies, right? Clearly there are things happening. Clearly things are not bleached out. So what is happening? And why explore the experiences of these two pan-ethnic groups in particular? Well, I argue that while Asian Americans and Latinos are diverse, heterogeneous, pan-ethnic groups, they also have experienced racialization in similar ways as racialized immigrants, right? The way that we think about these two groups is kind of befitting of the perpetual foreigner stereotype or image. So the path to legal, cultural, and social citizenship has been wrought with barrier, right, for members of these two groups. And in some respects, folks from these two groups occupy this liminal space between the polarities of black and white. And they are what sociologist Eileen O'Brien calls the racial middle, right? So smack in between black and white racial groups. So let's look at some numbers to further justify why I did this study. So we see that Asian Americans and Latinos are the fastest growing pan-ethnic groups in this country as projected by the Pew Research Center. And the Pew Research Center projects that Asian Americans and Latinos will be over 35% of the population by 2050. And that's just right around the corner, right? It's not too far away. So it is timely to understand how race is experienced by members of these two groups and how these experiences shape or then influence their identities as Americans. Now in law, their numbers have also increased, okay? So looking at this graph, we see that Asian Americans, which is the gray diamond, and Latinos, the blue square, the enrollment of these two groups has increased significantly since the early 1980s. Asian American and Latino lawyers are also entering the profession at an impressive rate. Yet there isn't really much discussion about how they got there. The discussions that we have about minority lawyers are really surrounding the experiences of black attorneys, which, you know, are needed and warranted. But what about, so this study looks at these two particular groups. So my work then situates these empirical puzzles that I attempt to solve by interjecting three sets of literature. This becomes kind of academic-y. I'm going to skip over it very quickly. These sets of literature that speak to one another, law and society literature, looking at what it means to be a professional. Immigrant adaptation literature, what it means for second generation immigrants to adapt to the United States, and race and ethnicity literature, what pan-ethnicity means in the context of our country. So let's see. My goals are rather simple, and I seek to answer the following questions. Right? How does pan-ethnicity matter for neophyte professionals? In this case, law students in particular. Why is this even important? Why do we even care? Right? And what does this tell us about race relations in the broader United States? So what are the implications, right, of the study? And I'll touch on all of these today. My data derives from interviews and participant observations at two differently tiered law schools, an elite top 10 and a local urban top 4 law school. Why? Right, why do this, right? Because most research on law schools have been more skewed toward elite institutions. And most law schools in this country are not elite institutions. So we don't really know what's even happening in our law schools. So I sought to understand schools from these two tiers to capture the similar nature of law school and law school curricula and law school culture, and also the dynamic experience of this profession. not my field sites, as I mentioned, Western elite, a top-tier law school, and then private metropolitan. So I was in the field for two academic years, 2009 to 2011, and engaged in non-participant observations of organization meetings and events. And I was, I used this intentional snowball sampling method where I asked the law students to refer me to their peers, not their friends, right, their peers in their small groups. Because law school cohorts are large in number in the hundreds, but these small groups are rather small and rather intimate. And they're diverse, consisting of people from various racial, ethnic backgrounds, gender, geography. So I explicitly asked the students to refer me to peers in the small groups that I could speak to mitigate selectivity bias as much as possible. I also engaged in this data entry exercise where I asked interning students to keep a diary, and we can talk about that as well. Okay, so the main findings, well, a couple things. Diversity matters, if not ostensibly, right? And racialization takes place on front and back stages, and I'll explain those. Students that have a firm trajectory, right, that want to go into firms, negotiate their various identities, and gender intersects with immigrant history. And I'll explain how, I'll briefly go over each of these, right, and then we can save time for Q&A. So let's start with the white students in the sample, okay? So I had white students as a control group, and the control is the basis by which, or the standard by which we make our comparisons, right? So white students in the sample ostensibly value diversity and exhibit something that I call paternalistic exoticism. Right? This category is then further divided into diversity sympathizers and operant indifference. Now, a diversity sympathizer recognizes race-based privilege and they value inclusion, while operant indifference uses coded language to talk about perhaps a lack of a need for diversity in law school and also espouse colorblind racism. So, for example, let's turn to Will Decker. Now, Will is from an upper middle class upbringing, and he attended elite private schools for primary and secondary education, and he is a typical diversity sympathizer. Now, he identified this thing called white dude culture when he and I were talking, right? And he says this culture is seeped within law. So I asked him, I said, you know, what is this white dude culture? Like, say more about it. And so Will says, it's a lot of white guys. Law school lawyers, it's a lot of white guys thinking about white guy issues a lot of the time. You do see when issues have come up about social justice or racial justice issues come up, you hear a lot of really ignorant and thoughtless comments that I wouldn't say are explicitly on their face racist, but certainly you see that, I think I see that more. In some of the comments I've heard and seen, and I'm not saying I'm hearing people make explicitly racist comments, but I'm just hearing a lot of things that don't involve a lot of critical thinking or compassion or anything like that, where people consider where they came from and how they got to where they are, and I'm not trying to exempt myself from this either. I do try to be critical of myself because a lot of the work I want to do is going to be directly tied to issues of race. And I am and will be working with lots of people of color. And I try to sort of interrogate the way that I'm thinking about these issues in the way I'm positioning myself and what I want to do. So Will wants to work, you know, for nonprofits in the future. So he sees himself as working with folks of color. Okay. So other white students espouse this operant indifference, right? Where they seem to ostensibly value diversity because it's good for business or becoming lawyers, the world is more globalized, so it's important, right? But at the same time, they use coded language to support colorblind racism. So we have Spencer Fagan here, right? He says, I mean, actually, I don't know how much diversity really matters because you're not really teaching anything. Well, I could see maybe more in substantive classes, but I don't know how much race really matters the first year because professors are just following the ABA, the American Bar Association, guidelines and just teaching the black letter law. So it's not like they would have too many insights. But I mean, obviously in a civil rights class, I can definitely see that being an important thing. So both diversity sympathizers and those who express operant indifference are captured within this overarching category of paternalistic exoticism. White students tend to exoticize the little diversity there is in law school to begin with, and they remain paternalistic towards non-whites. While white students may want to be allies, they continue to operate within what sociologist Joe Fagan calls the white racial frame, where legal, cultural, and institutional cultures remain white. This paternalism derives from a considerate and conscious place, but nevertheless marginalizes non-white law students. For students of color, then, I find that racialization happens in all terrains of law school. And this happens on the front stage, in law school classrooms, hallways, common areas, etc., and also the backstage, the panethnic organizations. So I'm going to delve into those right now. So first, let's look at the front stage, right? Classrooms, interactions with peers and professors, coursework, etc., are pre-lessons that obviate Asian Americans and Latinos as minorities in law school. They learn through visual cues and interactions that they are racial others. These lessons do not disappear over the first couple of weeks of law school because there's a culture shock, right? When one first goes onto campus and sees that there are so few co-panethnics, but this sense of othering does not disappear, and in fact continues through these three lessons of omissions, interactions, and assumptions. And as the table here shows us, right? The medium by which we see these lessons, omissions, that we see this happening in the classroom, and the paradox is an interesting experiential versus hypothetical race. Like, what does that mean, right? I'm going to unpack that a little bit. Interactions, medium, or the domain is the law school. The lesson is then this foreignizing of law students. And then assumptions, domains, law school, virtual legal world, and these lessons are race-based and assumptions about non-meritocratic admissions. All right. So, as illustration, let's look at Esperanza Macias' story of awareness through omission. So I'm going to engage with my book now and read a little excerpt, right, of Esperanza's story. So Esperanza was talking to me about her law school experience. She was a second year law student, and she was remembering a particular moment in property class during her first year of law school, and she became incensed. So she says, we were talking about, like, I don't remember what principle we were talking about, but it was a video about housing issues. Like, people think that too many people living in an apartment is not okay. Or the fact that a landlord is saying, I'm not going to fix your place because it was just we were watching this video about tenant issues. So it was more just to highlight, look, here's how housing can really be a problem in our community. And it was just tenants fighting with their landlords, and they would go to city council meetings, and they were just talking about, look, they don't fix the stairs when they're broken, and this and this and that and that. And so the lights are kind of off in the classroom, and everyone's on their laptops, and we're watching this video, and everyone's just paying attention. And there's this scene where the landlord goes up, and she's like, look, I'm tired of people telling me to fix their places. I'm tired of people trying to tell me I need to paint their apartment. I'm tired of people telling me they need a new refrigerator. And she's just complaining and complaining. She says that her tenants are too needy. And then she's like, besides, they act like, I don't know, they got like 20 Mexicans in there. And half the class kind of laughed. And I was like, that's really, it was so weird because it made me feel strange because they were laughing at this idea of like 20 Mexicans living in this apartment. I was like, hey, I'm Mexican. I'm sitting right here. You just laughed. I'm sitting right here. And I just remember for some reason it was like really personal to me that they would laugh at this woman being really ignorant, that they laughed at this very ignorant comment when we're supposed to be in this classroom full of very enlightened and intellectual people. It was like this out-of-body experience. I was like, I thought we're all supposed to be smart. And it made me feel weird because that's when I realized I was one of two Mexicans in the 90-person class. So as we see in this experience, right, the lack of acknowledgement or empathy on the part of her peers left Esperanza feeling othered in her classroom and feeling as if she does not belong. As for racial lessons through interactions, these can take place with professors, other students, or even guests in a classroom. And with that, let's turn to Marie's vignette. So Marie is she returned to school after working in a while in the environmental field, and she was really excited to work within environmental law when she was done with law school. And she was thrilled to be listening to this guest speaker in her class, because the speaker, as she described, was an older white man who had retired from the Bureau of Reclamation and had a wealth of professional knowledge. So after the speaker's presentation, Marie was bursting with questions, especially with regards to the connection between water use and agriculture, given her interest, right? It seems like a no-brainer question. It's an issue she feels passionate about, right? She recalled asking the speaker about the best way to interrogate the water needs of farmers on a national scale, but being interrupted by the speaker before she could finish. And he interrupted me and said, "So would you rather see a bunch of dry cleaners?" And at the time, I was so focused on my point that I didn't even realize how that was racist. But upon retrospect, it came out of nowhere. There was no reason for him to be so angry and defensive with me, because he had not done that with any other student. There was no reason for him to pick out dry cleaners aside from any other business, considering we're talking about the use of water and how it compares with agriculture uses and urban uses. It makes a lot more sense to say something like high-rises or suburban development or anything else that uses a lot of water. I don't even know how much dry cleaners use or don't use. I mean, it just made no sense. Why would he say that for the fact that I was one of the few Asian American people in the room? And it may be unconsciously that just came to his head. I don't know until you ask him, right? But also the force with which he responded and the way in which he disregarded my point, the way that he was almost angry with me before I got my point across, completely, completely affects me. And this, when I talked to Marie, she was a first-year law student. And so this experience really left her wondering, right, what it was about being Asian American in law school. So while some may think this exchange to be trivial, clearly it affected the way Marie thinks about the value of race for her as an Asian American person in the profession. This assumption based on phenotype alone conjures not only racializing, but also foreignizing towards particular immigrant groups, our images of why, you know, certain groups may own dry cleaners. This type of assumption would not be made toward a white student, for example. So lastly, there are these lessons about race through assumptions made by white students and white faculty about students of color, especially around law school admissions. So Jenna Ito is a native of Hawaii, and she was shocked when a white student asked her to what it felt like to be the product of affirmative action, right? So she shares this with me. So we're talking about, you know, coming to law school, and she says, "I definitely had a lot of comments made to me during orientation when I came to private metropolitan. For first year orientation, one student asked what it felt like to be the product of affirmative action. And I said, was this another Asian American student? And she said, no, this was a white student. And I asked, what did you say to that? And she said, I didn't say anything. I was shocked. I was like, I'm sorry? What? And he was like, yeah, because there aren't that many of you here. And by you, I'm assuming he meant people of color. So he's like, there aren't that many of you here, so I'm assuming that you're here because of affirmative action, so that must have been really interesting to you. And I'm sure you'll love to learn about it in constitutional law, or something like that. He said something along those lines. And I asked, and this was another first-year student, and Jenna said, mm-hmm. So I just didn't say anything. I wasn't sure what to make of it. I'm not sure if he was rude or if he was really stupid, really ignorant. And I have to note, so in the epilogue of my book, I talk about how I've started to re-interview some of these respondents, and Jenna was one of these people. And when I asked her about, you know, race in the professions, this story, right, she brought up the story again. So clearly it affected her to such a level that she retold the same story that she had told me like 6 years ago. All right. So although targeted questions like these are few and far between, it's not as if this happens on a daily basis, they nevertheless happen to non-white students based on the assumption that they could not have earned a place in law school based on merit alone. These types of scenario were repeatedly shared by my respondents. So contending with this front stage racialization, right, through these lessons, then leads many Latino and Asian American students to seek out refuge among co-panethnics, which I term backstage racialization. And I have to know, I'm not making a causal statement. I'm just saying that this happens. There's also backstage stuff happening too. So it's important to note that to the contrary of what we may believe, the non-white law students in my study were not involved in panethnic organizations in college. I thought they would be, right? Because these were folks that were involved in panethnic organizations in law school. It made sense to have that trajectory, but they were not. If you look here, these were the students who were involved in affinity groups, right, from my sample. The percentages are rather low, but the top three extracurricular activities in law school were working, pre-law societies, mentoring, volunteering, department-specific orgs, you know, things that led them to law school. They were not so much preoccupied with affinity groups, which doesn't differ that much from the white students, right? White students didn't talk about affinity groups in law school, perhaps, or in college. Perhaps there are now, but that was not something that came up during our conversation. But so what happened in law school? Law school clearly changed that trajectory, right? Because these students are, for the most part, involved in these organizations. So why did law students become involved in affinity groups in law school? We'll turn to An. So An says, you know, because, well, the people there look like me. I started going to meetings, and also people in SALS, the Society of Asian American Law Students, kind of reached out and said, oh, come join SALS or come to a meeting. So I think seeing that people were involved and that they're always trying to recruit, that's really helpful. And I joined the Western Elite Technology Journal last year, but I definitely did not stay, not because the people were not nice, but I just didn't connect with them on a personal level. I kind of felt like an outsider in that journal. I don't know if it's that important, but maybe it's subconscious. I think some people just don't try very hard to talk to you. One thing that I didn't realize was how much beer that white Americans drink, which is something that these students in the Technology Journal engaged in a lot last year, and it's something that I don't really do. Right? So even these like lack of interest in speaking to the student primarily, or the cultural differences led on and other Asian American students to seek out their pan-ethnic groups. So being seen as racial others and experiencing these microaggressions, right, then leads these students to seek out a home away from home, a community that understands them. These pan-ethnic student organizations become these one-stop shops for my respondents, providing professional, academic, and social support. The students then align themselves with pan-ethnicity and begin to identify more as pan-ethnic law students. But even so, some Latino and Asian American students have career aspirations that often do not reflect what their peers expect of them, right? Especially as more recent immigrants. And these students want to go on and join big law firms, and they are then called sellouts by their peers. So, here, for example, Araceli says, I feel like here at Western Elite, I had to make some comments to people who would make comments like, oh, so-and-so is selling out because going into private company or whatever. And I feel like if your heart isn't helping, but just in a different way, that doesn't mean it should be dismissed. If you can get a Latino student to be a clerk of some sort, everybody would be very excited. But the steps that lead up to it, oh, you're in law review. You might get some flack for it. And I don't think that's right, because the whole point is getting people in positions that could help others. Now, Law Review is a premier journal in law schools, and as opposed to like pan-ethnic journals, right? The Asian American Law Journal, etc. So these students, you know, feel as if they're getting flack for it if they're selling out. But mainstream aspirations then are seen as, you know, not contributing to one's community, right? So as such, the students who intend to sell out or work for law firms have found ways to manage their identities, have found ways to inject pan-ethnicity into what they intend to do. So these three strategies, they use something I call marginal pan-ethnicity, tempered altruism, and instrumental ethnicity. So I'll discuss each of them briefly. Marginal panethnicity refers to law students who see being panethnic as something marginal to their lawyer identities. They may take part in clinics or work on increasing co-panethnic representation in law. Joshua Veracruz says, what I'm trying to do through SALS now is to connect our alumni to undergrads so we have a stream of community so that people feel connected. So undergrads feel encouraged to apply to law school so they can better understand what the profession is and that they can or can't get out of law degree, and to encourage them as much as possible and to just be out there. And just because Asian Americans are underrepresented in law school and in the legal community, it shouldn't stop them from wanting to do it. It should cause them to want to apply to law school even more. So Joshua addresses the need for more Asian American representation in law, and his focus on giving back is directly tied to his law schooling experience. The next strategy, tempered altruism, is often spoken of by Asian American Latino law students who want to combine their legal practice with giving back to their respective communities. So Luis Perez here says, I grew up in a mostly poor, predominantly Latino neighborhood, and I'm very proud of where I've come from. A part of being a successful attorney to me would be to work with communities like this, really, in any way that I can, whether it be mentoring high school or college kids, or providing free legal services to these types of groups, or participating in legal clinics, or taking on some pro bono work, whatever it may be. Students who espouse tempered altruism see a need to use their legal skills to help communities, whether it's direct action or through pro bono services in their future law firms. And finally, some students use what I call instrumental ethnicity. These students typically have a strong relationship to their respective panethnic communities and are often attending law school in the same region that where they are raised. And they often possess language skills and feel they can fill an important niche, like Anderson Lee. Now he says, I want to be a bridge for the Korean American community to be able to utilize American legal system because they have these barriers. One, for language, and two, cultural difference. I actually have spoken with some Korean business owners who have been sued, and they want to stay away from the whole legal system, period. My sense was they are really afraid of the whole legal process. So I want to be able to be a bridge because of my language ability, because I feel like I need to help them understand what's going on instead of living in their own little world so the Korean community can grow and be a part of America. All right, so this typology for identity management then falls in line with several like criteria shared here in this table. We can talk about them more later should you be interested, but there were differences, right? Students who did not grow up in the same region as where they were attending law school more likely espoused marginal panethnicity, and these were students who typically grew up in white suburbs, whereas tempered altruism, there was a mix. Some students who grew up in suburbs, some who did not. And this was further divided into the cultivated, those who did, and then the organic, or those who did not, and the organic, those who did. And then instrumental ethnicity, same region as the law school, grew up in or near ethnic enclaves, spoke proficient or fluent in an ethnic language, but also only students from private metropolitan, the lower ranked institution. Right? So that was fascinating to consider as well, and that's something we can talk about should you be interested. All right, so lastly, the last thing that emerged from the study is how gender matters in this racialization and professional socialization of students of these two racial groups. So specifically, women must shoulder gendered expectations from their profession and their parents as a part of their law schooling. The gender typecasting takes place in three ways: future mommies and filial daughters, angry and submissive women of color, and also becoming too intimidating, right? So let's start with Joy T's vignette. And this captures the type of gender stereotyping experienced by women law students writ large. So Joy T says, I went to one interview where the interviewer said straight out, we're not cosmopolitan. Translation, we're not diverse. And then he starts talking about how all the women left to do the mommy thing. So I sat there, knowing he sees me as a South Asian female. And I've had that experience at least once or twice more, where it was that direct. Right? These assumptions about gender and race come out in these types of interview settings. So in addition to contending with professional stereotypes, women law students also feel burdened to take care of their families. Respondent Martha Ortiz feels pressure to not only do well in law school so she could secure a good job, but she also has to set a good example for her three younger siblings to ensure that they go to college. She plans to help finance her education while also taking care of her parents. In our conversation, she told me that her youngest sibling had no interest in college, and so she told him, she bribed him, that she would buy him a car, right, if he went to college. And so it'd be interesting to follow up and see if she actually did buy him a car. So these types of filial daughters' expectations conjure immigrant background, as most of these respondents are second generation immigrants. The second way that the women are typecast is through their peers. They are fearful that they will be seen as angry women of color because they feel passionate about particular topics, especially those that tend to affect their communities. And as Felicia here says, I don't want to offend people, and I also don't want to be the angry woman of color. people characterize other women or peers that speak on these topics of race and gender as angry, as frustrated. They can't empathize with them. I think people have grown up in such segregated societies, and especially at this caliber of a school at Western Elite, and in graduate education, period. It's a pretty heteronormative white student body, so I'm pretty rational, pretty articulate, fact-based. I'm not talking with passion, but still these issues are issues that I think my classmates in America in general are uncomfortable with. So with that discomfort comes stereotypes, and I think the angry woman of color image is definitely alive. Lastly, Latinas and Asian American women have parents that often fear that they will become too intimidating by becoming lawyers. In this way, they try to carve out a career trajectory for them and do not understand when their daughters do not comply. Right? Andrea here shares how her dad finds her to be wasting her time. She says, "My dad's always very, very critical about everything. So when I first switched over from poli-sci to global studies in college, he was like, 'What's that? You can't even say that in Spanish.' And then going to law school, he was like, 'So what kind of law are you doing? Are you doing immigration law?' And it was one of those things where he automatically assumed that's what I was doing. And then when I told him that I was doing entertainment law, he was like, 'You're wasting your time going to law school then.'" And overall, this was only applied to my women of color respondents, right? I didn't see this with my white male students, with my white women students, or my male students of color. This was a gendered phenomenon. Parents and wanting the best for their daughters assert themselves in their children's decision making, and as we saw here, Andrea's father could not comprehend why she would want to do entertainment law instead of immigration law, because he felt she was better suited for that. So I hope I've demonstrated that for Asian American and Latinos, becoming a lawyer is surely not a bleached out process, right? And it's actually quite nuanced, layered, and requires constant negotiation and renegotiation. So racialization happens incidentally in these three short years through front stage interactions and backstage allegiances. This book then really looks at the diverse ways in which assimilation or integration can happen and on different levels. I argue there are two paths of assimilation in law school. There's elite professionalization and legal socialization by way of the substantive findings that we talked about, right? Diversity in the profession, front stage, backstage racialization, identity of these firm-bound law students, and the typecast socialization of Latinas and Asian Americans. What are the broader implications? Well, there are many, as law school is really just a microcosm of American society. I use a law school context as a case study to understand how racialization not only persists, but reinvigorates in certain segments of society, especially at the elite stratum. The immigrant experience is diverse, and we need context-specific investigation to further understand its complexity. Immigrant adaptation that happens at different levels of society, schools, organizations, and broader immigrant communities, these diverse venues and routes of assimilation then constitute this malleable racial order. So for attorneys in general, especially law students, we've peered into their lives a little bit. Research on non-white law attorneys find that many are concentrated in ethnic niches or nonprofit organizations. Why? Right? A sense of affinity or altruism generally leads them there, but it also seems that these non-white attorneys are driven to these outlets because they experience alienation in mainstream jobs. This theoretical conjecture speaks to larger processes of covert discrimination within a society that normalizes and prioritizes a white racial framework. So for Latinos and Asian American lawyers, becoming a part of mainstream America is to experience long periods, if not an entire career's worth, of incidental racialization.
The model minority and probably like overrepresented in all these elite professions.
Yeah, so Asian American representation in law school has, so I refer to this Yale study, right? So what the Yale study found was that, you know, of all racialized groups, Asian Americans were the most like represented, aside from whites, right? And they're on par to black African Americans. But what they found was that in the big law firm trajectory, what they saw was of all the racial groups, Asian Americans were the ones that were deflecting at the fastest rates, right? So what's happening? And whereas, you know, yeah, there's deflection of lawyers in general in these big law firms, but, you know, they're deflecting faster than Latinos, faster than African Americans. You know, where are they going and what is happening? So that's the question there, is what I'm seeking in my next study. right, where I'm looking at the professions and how race matters in medicine, in law, and also in finance.
Do you think the experience may have been different for each of the pan-ethnic groups at a non-white racial majority law school environment, such as HSBC,
mm-hmm.
or like at University of Hawaii School of Law,
yeah.
where Asians are the predominant majority? Do you think the experiences may have been different for the groups?
Maybe in terms of the sense of racial alienation, perhaps not, right? But the context, you know, what we've seen in race and ethnicity literature is that despite the increase in numbers, when the culture doesn't shift, right, when the culture kind of remains the status quo and is based on this kind of European American like elite history, then that itself can be alienating. So I would suspect, right, there would be some complexities at play. Like there's like kind of this racial majority, but also the culture itself and the language itself is alienating. So there may be some identity negotiation and conflict in that regard. But that said, so a couple of my respondents, right, are working in, that I followed up with, are working in minority majority types of situations, right, whether they're like ones in Hawaii and there are a couple in the LA area where the organizations where they work are predominantly folks who look like them and are other co-pan-ethnics, right, and they still feel alienated. And they do because those who are in charge, right, the people they report to tend to be white. The professions, the types of literature they get about the professions still are kind of encased in this language that you know, supports kind of like the dominant. Yeah. Follow up?
Yeah, a follow up question to that question. Do you think then the experiences of white students in those same type of settings mm-hmm. would have been different?
I think
a white student at Howard University.
Sure. Yeah.
And how so?
I think there would certainly be a sense of alienation, but also I think when you look at the professors, right? So who are teaching in these institutions, right? Even at these, you know, like Howard, for example, like the professors are probably primarily white, right? And so the types of mentorship that's available too might also be different. And I think it's an interesting question. It's certainly worthy of investigation. Yes, John.
Did you do any analysis of the difference between the Asian students and the Latino students?
Mm-hmm.
Did they diverge in their perceptions or experience based on sort of differential stereotyping?
Yeah, so that was interesting, right? Because this is the thing with qualitative research. You kind of go into the field making these assumptions, like, oh, this is going to happen, whatever. But what I really found was that there was a lot more similar between them than there were differences, and that surprised me. In part because, I think because of where my samples were drawn, right? So the two institutions. So Western Elite is this elite institution. I had kind of assumed that most of the respondents were going to be from, you know, upper middle class backgrounds, right, with professional parents. But what I found was a bimodal distribution, right? I had a cluster of students who had parents who were doctors, lawyers, professors, etc., and then a cluster of students whose parents, you know, were high school graduates. And this was the same across, you know, racial groups for Asian Americans and Latinos. Whereas at private metropolitan, right, remember when I mentioned the instrumental ethnicity thing and I thought that was interesting, it was only private metropolitan where the students did this. The students that were like solid middle class, and they went to good undergraduate institutions, they just did really poorly on the LSAT, right? Because the LSAT is kind of the determining factor of getting into law schools, right? And they did really poorly. And so, and their experiences are kind of like this, like middle class experiences. So I was surprised. I think if anything, class played more of a role between these students and perhaps in what they were telling me. I don't know how things have changed, right, now that they've been in the profession for for some of them, almost 10 years, right? So what that looks like now, I think, would be interesting to gauge. Yeah. Yes, hi.
I'm totally newbie as to sociology.
Yes.
And
welcome.
I came to this partly because I had no idea what you were talking about with your book title.
Mm.
Incidental Racialization.
Yes.
Performative Assimilation in Law School. Could you explain each word?
I will explain each word. So incidental, like what I mean by that, right? So I'm saying that in the professions, what's happening is that racialization isn't something that the professors or the deans or anyone's thinking about. They're not thinking we're going to racialize these students, right? And so what I'm saying is that these interactions happen in law school, and these organizations are available in law school. So then racialization, this kind of affinity to these pan-ethnic groups, it's incidental. It's just something that just happens as opposed to intentional. Okay. Yeah. And racialization is the process of adopting a race, because if we think about, you know, what racial categories are, they're just umbrella categories, right, that encompass various ethnic groups. So Asian Americans, you know, the ethnic groups that are encompassed under this umbrella are what, Chinese, Korean, Japanese, various South Asian, Bangladeshi, etc. So that's the racialization part, like how we as ethnic individuals then kind of become part of this racial group, right? And I argue that a lot of that had to do with not only the interactions in the classrooms, but also the availability of these specific pan-ethnic organizations. Because there wasn't like a Chinese law student organization, right? There was an Asian American law student organization. All right, performative assimilation, in that, you know, this was kind of a play on sociological, play on kind of Irving Goffman. It's how we perform, you know, our identities, right? So the way that these students then kind of embody their racial identities in the classroom or in the organizations, right? That's where the performative comes in. And I argue that performative assimilation, that assimilation, this is a one way where we can assimilate, right? Because immigration theorists have talked about these various processes. You've heard of perhaps like the melting pot, right, or the tossed salad, and these are just kind of words to describe assimilation. And so what I'm saying here is that assimilation can also be performative in the law school setting, right, because of the way that students are then racialized and then in law school. So I hope that helps a little bit. Well, thanks. Well, we could talk more about it. Yeah. So tempered altruism refers to, so these are all law students who are going to go to big firms or go to law firms, not just big firms, right? They're not going to do immigration law. They're not going to work in communities because they have various reasons for going to firms. One perhaps is to pay back their loans, right? Because it costs a lot to go to law school. That's what we've seen in the literature. Students who kind of start out with altruistic intentions on going to law school, they end up going kind of the firm trajectory, right? Because that's what pays the bills, is that route. So I'm going to clarify that. This is all students going to firms. Okay. So tempered altruism are the students who are going to firms and they are thinking, you know, I'm going to go to a firm, but I'm also going to do pro bono work. And I'm going to dedicate like my weekends to volunteering at the immigration clinic. Or I'm going to do, or if there's a law school that needs this type of activity, you know, legal services, like I'm going to do that. So that's tempered altruism. And that's split to the cultivated and the organic, right? So cultivated are the students who, you know, learned about issues that are important to pan-ethnic communities in college or in law school, so perhaps through like ethnic studies classes. One student really talked about his experiences with ethnic studies in that regard. And then so there's the cultivated, and the organic are the students who grew up in or near, you know, pan-ethnic or ethnic communities, right? In or near Chinatown, right? In or near Koreatown, in or near I'm trying to think of other places, I'm drawing a blank, but you know, in or near ethnic communities. And so they kind of knew some of the issues. So they're going to firms, but they're committed to also doing stuff on the weekends maybe, or when they're not busy or whatever, right? So this is the tempered altruism. And whereas instrumental ethnicity is the students, you know, they know they're going to firms, but they're going to work for firms that specifically serve their communities or have a mission to serve those communities or are situated within those communities. And they do this because they have language ability, because they can speak Spanish, because they can speak Korean, because they can speak Mandarin. And so that's where the instrumental part comes in.
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't talk to professors, right, for this study, but it would be interesting also to see what professors' perceptions are, especially of each other. And, you know, what, right? Because like we hear students' perceptions of professors, but we don't know what professors' perceptions are of each other, you know, anonymously.
But I think they're human beings, they make mistakes.
Sure.
Although the best expect them to be perfect,
yeah,
in their conduct, but it doesn't really happen that way.
Yeah.
At the idealistic way to see it.
Right. Yeah. Well, thank you. Other questions or comments? Yes.
Yeah, I'm wondering if you considered, I know that the focus of your data collection was the interviews of these respondent students. But you know, as you, I was just thinking as you were defining each word, mm-hmm. the title of your book, the incidental part, and I'm wondering how incidental the racialization is at these law schools, because if you think about like the admissions process,
right. Right?
I mean, affirmative action does play somewhat of a role, whether, you know, in the favor of an applicant of color,
sure.
or against the applicant of color, you know, whatever the case may be. And then, you know, once the students are admitted, mm-hmm. particularly in 1L classes,
yes.
like where you have, you know, maybe two or three 1L sections at a particular law school. And I'll bet that or anyone, mm-hmm. did a study of like 95% of the law schools where the overwhelming majority of the students are mm-hmm. white, that you'll see that the distribution of the students of color, or the non-white students, mm-hmm. or mixed race students even, are probably more evenly distributed amongst the first year section mm-hmm. than you would see with a random assignment mm-hmm. with 1L sections. And so I don't remember that student's name, that Mexican American student who realized that she was just one of two in that class. Like if there were maybe 20 Mexican students in first year law mm-hmm. school class, and there were three different 1L sections, mm-hmm. I mean, you probably wouldn't see like 10 of them mm-hmm. clustered in one of the sections. You'd mm-hmm. probably see more of an even distribution. And so the reason why I mentioned that
yeah.
is because the feelings of alienation and being the only mm-hmm. of a particular background or mm-hmm. group, it is probably more engineered than mm-hmm. it is incidental.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody actually examined the practices of the law school registrars.
Mm-hmm. I think, you know, I understand your point with regard to that. So there's like kind of the ascriptive racialization, right? And the kind of assertive racialization. So I think more so the incidental in this regard, especially with backstage, is the assertive racialization that we don't think about necessarily, right, as being part of this racialization process. So I do think, like, certainly law schools do play a hand, right, in the initial ascriptive, but the fact that these students weren't assertively identifying themselves as, you know, pan-ethnically Latino or pan, because they were saying they're Mexican, they're Salvadoran, but they're joining these organizations and they're going to these, you know, causes that are, or tutoring students that are of other ethnic groups, but part of the racial, right, if you will, because Latino is not a race, but, you know, the experiences of Latinos have been racialized. So, in that regard is where I think the difference in the assertive comes in. But yeah, I think you raise a good point though. Well, thank you so much for coming. And I am reachable by email, I'm, you know, local. So happy to, you know, grab coffee and continue this conversation whenever. So thank you so much. Thank you.